everything turn, turn, turn. There is a season, turn, turn, turn. And a time to every purpose under heaven. A time to be born, a time to die, a time to plant, a time to reap, a time to kill, a time.
Hello, Steve Garvin here, Far West board member, artist manager, lifelong country rock aficionado. Far West is proud to present the first in a series, Best of the West and Beyond. This one is Chris Hillman, Time Between, his life as a Byrd, Burrito Brother, and beyond. This series will honor and share sessions with some previous Best of the West honorees, as well as other influential and musically distinguished artists. Chris Hillman is a stellar example of that. Rock and Roll Hall of Famer, 1991. Americana, 2004 Lifetime Achievement Award. Colorado Music Hall of Fame. 4 Grammy nominations. 4 CMA nominations. ACM Band of the Year 3 times. And 2 separate BMI Million Broadcast Radio performances. Wow. Chris's journey started in California in the 1950s. His exposure to folk and bluegrass lit his lifelong musical fire. Rock and Americana only added to this amazingly diverse career. Today, LA area music journalist Randy Lewis interviews Chris. Kind thanks to Far West Board, Chris and Connie Hillman, Carrie Baker, and Julie Zipperer. Looking forward to seeing many of you again in person down the road. Onward to great story, music, amazing artist, Chris Hillman. Thanks. And you see the book cover in the background there? And here's my Gilded Palace of Sin Flying Burrito Brothers t-shirt. Take care.
From my humble point of view, she don't love nobody. Nothing borrowed, nothing blue. She don't love nobody. Behind the green eyes I detect, she don't love nobody. A heart no kiss could resurrect. She don't love nobody all her life.
Well, hello, my name is Randy Lewis. I've been writing about pop music for I think since music was invented, it feels like. Spent about 4 decades covering pop music for the Los Angeles Times. And I'm here today with Chris Hillman, one of my favorite musicians over the years, as many of you, I'm sure, know him as one of the founding members of the Byrds, also the Flying Burrito Brothers. From there was with Stephen Stills in Manassas, the member of the Souther Hillman Furay Band, McGuinn Clark and Hillman, the Desert Rose Band, one of the great alt country bands of the 80s and 90s, and has collaborated with just all sorts of incredible people in the music world. And it's a treat to get to talk to him on this occasion, which is inspired in, to some degree, by Chris's new autobiography called Time Between, which is a delightful read full of insights, illuminations, stories that some are hilarious, some are very poignant. And it's just a terrific read. So I recommend it highly. And with that, we'd like to jump in. Chris, welcome to this event and good to see you.
Thank you, Randy. That was such a lovely introduction. Thank you so much. Undeserving, I might add. But no, very nice. And yes, we have enjoyed you for many years in the LA Times. Many, many years in wonderful articles. But yeah, let's talk.
Well, so where I wanted to start before we dive into a lot of the particulars, which I think will be fun for this audience, but just in general, you know, I think you've had any number of opportunities over the years to put a book together. And, you know, you and I have talked about that on occasion, but why now? And you had, you know, often said, you know, you weren't interested in a, you know, tell all, where are all the skeletons hiding, who did what to whom kind of a book that happens a lot. But what was the roadmap for you for this, you know, what put you on the path that led to the book?
Well, you know, it's so funny. I didn't have it like, someday I'm going to write a book. I don't think I ever thought that way, but somehow it just all fell together. And I said, you know, I just started writing. It was very funny. I was very ambitious, Randy, at the beginning. I thought, well, I'm going to do two volumes. Unbeknownst to me, two volumes, volume one and volume two. Volume one, growing up in California, which I thought was a very interesting part of my life or anybody else's my age. Growing up post-World War II in California, it was quite interesting. But initially I thought, well, I'll write about that and then I'll talk about the music. And finally I realized, no, I really, it's a little too ambitious. So one volume ought to suffice. And a lot of it was just putting down the story for the family, for my kids. And in the interim, while I was putting this together, of course, I had two grandkids come along. So we have a wonderful thing to leave them. A part of it was, you know, I had read so many books on the birds and the burritos and so many sometimes inaccuracies and things that I felt, well, I'd like to clear that up. And I've mentioned that before to people and they say, well, what specifically? It's hard for me to say, well, specifically this happened or that, but I didn't go there. But basically that's it. And I, by the grace of God, I remembered just about everything. And when we finally had, I'm sitting here with a manuscript on my shelf after working on it for a few years, it's sitting on my shelf. And I said to my wife, I think we should find an agent and get this published. And at the same time, I meet Scott B. Bomar from BMG, who heads up the publishing division. And he was interested. He'd heard I was writing and he wanted to read some chapters. And I know this is a long answer, but there's an end to this answer. I sent him a couple chapters. He loved it. He said, let's talk. And the nicest thing he said was, we don't need a co-writer. And I was very happy with that, that he felt I was okay to handle this by myself, that I could write this book. And we did it, off we went. But that's when I really got involved in the book. I started to rewrite it to get rid of excess things that weren't needed. Connie, my wife, had some great editing ideas. Scott Bomar had some great editing ideas, especially opening the story with this fire that we were involved in Ventura, where we live. But it just sort of came together. It was a daily process. And you know this better than I do, Randy. You've been a writer a lot longer than I have and certainly can make that claim. But you get into this process of a daily thing and it's really, I enjoyed it. I enjoyed doing this quite a bit.
Yeah, as I say, it's like a river, you know, you just stay in the stream.
You stay in the stream, but the first person to look at the book and edit it was my daughter, who's an English lit teacher, high school. And she was merciless because she's going through the book and grammar editing. And and so she'd be reading and said, it was like heaven on earth. Really, Dad? Big red pencil. I said, well, you know, you're in the process and you're writing and you just keep going. You write silly stuff, like, you know, the typical cliched stuff that comes up. But she was so funny. Straightened that out and then off we went. So,
well, in one conversation we had, we also you talked about Linda Ronstadt's book.
Yes.
That she had written a few years ago.
Yeah.
And the fact that she opted to really focus on the music. I mean, she calls it a musical memoir. And that seemed to be something that was, you know, helpful to you in thinking about
very much so.
how you would take it on.
I don't know why I picked up Linda's book, because I hadn't made it really a habit of reading autobiographies. I think I read Keith Richards, But I read Linda's and I loved it because she never denigrated anybody she worked with. It was about her musical journey and it was perfectly spot on. I loved that. And she writes well, and it was interesting. And I think I sent her a note and I said, this is very inspiring because I followed that to a T. And when I started this book, I didn't feel it necessary to denigrate or go dark or negative with anybody I worked with. Oh, there were times I wanted to strangle people, you know, and I'm sure they wanted to strangle me, but that's part of working in a musical ensemble that those things happen. You're all trying to attain the same goal. I always had this wonderful, analogy, metaphor. Well, every band member is holding a paintbrush and you're painting the Mona Lisa's smile, right? And if you get that right as four or five people, you're there, but it doesn't always work that way. But Linda's book was very enjoyable and very, as I say, inspiring, is that she stayed right within the parameters of her musical career, which is what I tried to do too.
Right. Well, you were both part of this remarkable community, era. Music community era, and just this whole vibe that was going on here. And we could talk a little bit about that. But, the chronology of the book, you do talk about growing up in San Diego County in the community of Rancho Santa Fe, which was pretty mm-hmm. rural for those who may not be familiar with it. Mm-hmm. And it was really interesting to me to read sort of what the environment was for you growing up. And you talk in the early part of the book about the wide open spaces of Rancho Santa Fe and kind of the freedom that gave you as a kid growing up. And I thought, you know, do you think that might have fueled your musical imagination later on, this search for new frontiers that you were on? I mean, I really thought that there was a interesting connection maybe.
Oh, I think so. There were a lot of elements. Okay. Music was a big part of my family. No one played. I think my brother, it's funny, my brother, who's 6 years older than I am, actually took guitar lessons. And you'll love this, Randy, because he had a arch top F hole acoustic guitar. 1950, 51, he's just about starting junior high school, and he's learning guitar from a guitar teacher, and he's learning NOLA, and just silly stuff and reading music. And I'm going, well, there was nothing, there really wasn't rock and roll going on too much in 1950 or anything. Right. He stayed with that for about 6 months or a year. And I didn't have any inclination to do that yet. I was a six-year-old kid, actually. But we had music in the house. My parents loved music. I mean, they were from the generation that would go out dancing, you know, on dates and things. So what did we have in the house? We had Count Basie and Duke Ellington. We had young Peggy Lee. We had Ella Fitzgerald, Sinatra, of course, Dean Martin. I mean, just they had really terrific taste. So we would hear that all the time in the house, but like I say, nobody played an instrument or anything. So that element of that, and then growing up in this very rural area and having absolutely what you say, freedom. This was the era where your parents would say, you get your work done and be back by 5 o'clock, meaning you got your work done at home and off you went on your bike, or in my case, my horse or my bike, and be back by 5 o'clock. And that was the rules. But also there was other elements of growing up at that time. And I always hold up the fact I survived a very interesting, insidious to some degree, business in the music business. But I really feel the first 12 years of my life that my parents taught me really stuck with me. Responsibility, work ethic, values, morals to some degree. But they were insistent upon that and manners and things like that. And it was just such a great time. But all of those elements and then having that freedom, like you said, did lend itself to my musical taste later on, you know, I just fell madly in love with folk music and then bluegrass, but we'll discuss that. But it wasn't something we listened to, but I got a funny thing. I don't think I put this in the book, but one time I found my dad had a album of 78s, which was 78 album with 78s in it. Mm-hmm. And it was Woody Guthrie. And I couldn't, and here I am in the midst of the folk boom, 1960, 61, learning guitar and listening to Woody Guthrie records on Folkways albums and those kind of things. And I find this album, I go to my dad, I said, Dad, is this yours? He says, yeah. Wow, I didn't know you liked Woody Guthrie. He says, well, I sort of remember him being on the radio in the early 40s, and I bought this album, and I didn't get much more out of him about that. It was really interesting that he had that. I think he had a Josh White album too, so go figure, I don't know. And I forgot about that. I actually just remembered that about a week or two ago, finding that album of Woody Guthrie. So that's another connection. So their love of music, my love of music. And of course, here I am in the fifth grade, sixth grade, 1955, 1956, and Elvis Presley hits, comes out huge. I don't think any of us ever heard Good Rockin' Tonight or the early Sun stuff, but we did hear Heartbreak Hotel when he really started to take off. And of course, 56, we had Little Richard and Fats Domino, and it's wonderful music. I loved it, every bit of it, but I did not have any inclination or desire to pick up a guitar or learn how to play guitar yet.
Right. As
rock and roll sort of went to sleep, I call it, when it was about 1958, 59, all of a sudden you weren't hearing Chuck Berry on the radio as much or Little Richard. You heard Fabian and Frankie Avalon and all that. But then again, on the other side of the fence, folk music was really taking off college campuses, folk and jazz. And that was my introduction to it. It was my sister in the book. I write my older sister coming home from college and with a bunch of albums. And here we had just had a big hit with the Kingston Trio, Tom Dooley. Mm-hmm. And I liked the Kingston Trio. I liked it for about 10 minutes. And I got into a heavier thing with Guthrie and Seeger, Pete Seeger, Cisco Houston, the Weavers, this and that, through the New Lost City Ramblers, which I really loved, the string band music, pre-bluegrass. And I'm in high school. Then I hear bluegrass. I hear flattened scruggs. I went, oh my God, what is that? It was improvisational. It was exciting, high intensity music, unbelievably great singing, duets, trios, quartets singing. And it hit a nerve with me. And that's what it did it. I wanted to learn the guitar. And later I learned the mandolin. Still learning it.
That's great. Well, one of the other things that stuck out to me about, childhood growing up in those circumstances, and you mentioned that you had a horse when you were a kid, Ranger, and you mentioned in the book that you had to learn that when you got a horse you have to show him who's boss.
Oh yeah.
And I thought, well, that must have come in handy later on for some of the mavericks that that you were involved with in these different bands.
Some of them were on the verge of being wild broncos at times, but yeah, that did figure in prominently. And I remember it wasn't John Robertson who I wrote a song about, but there was a fellow named Jess McMillan who also taught me, and he was no holds barred. What the hell are you doing? Get back on that horse. Is he running your life or are you running his life? I'm 7 years old. Part of me is going, whoa, who's this guy? It just was right on. I mean, I just, yeah, okay. And I got back on the horse and he got on a line and I'd say, hey, and I wouldn't have too much problem with that after that. So it took me a little while in the Byrds. I was such a shy kid that it took a little while before I finally got hold of that situation. I'll put it that way. Mm-hmm. I was the young kid. I think Mike Clark, the drummer, and I were the youngest. Gene Clark, we were the three youngest kids, and McGuinn and Crosby were two, three years older than we were, which in your early 20s is a big gap.
Right.
Two, three years is a big gap. So anyway.
Yeah. Well, and your parents were supportive when you started showing interest in music, which mm-hmm. I thought was pretty touching. You talk a little bit about your mother buying you your first guitar and how that worked out.
Yeah, I mean, it was so funny. I said, I want to learn the guitar. And she said, well, let's just, because having dealt with my brother who stuck with it for what, you know, 6 months, like I say, 6 months to a year, maybe. She said, okay, well, let's just get something that you can start on. And we went to Tijuana, and I swear to you, it was $10. Well, 1960, $10 for a guitar. It played well. It was okay. It held up for a while and then it collapsed. But she did make a deal with me. She said, if you stick with this, I'll help you get another guitar, a better one, which meant she'd kick in a little money, meaning I had to earn the money to get the guitar, which was, I already was wise to her methods. So, but she kept her word. And when that guitar folded and I was still playing after 6 months, we went shopping for a guitar. And I wasn't quite sure what I was going to do. So I get a Goya nylon string guitar. And I was totally into the folk thing. And that lasted for a while until I heard bluegrass. And I put steel strings on the Goya, which turned it into a pretzel. It just completely warped it up. But it was just a funny time. Who knew? I was learning just like everybody else, you know.
Well, there's a great story too in the book that I think this audience would be particularly attuned to, that when you did go shopping for a better guitar, it was around that time. And I think it was in a music store, Frank's music store. You got the one that got away.
Oh, well, the one that got away was my brother-in-law would do a refinishing for this gentleman in San Diego, Frank. I can't remember his last name, but he had antiques, and he had, once in a while, he'd have instruments. And I went down with him one day to pick up a table that he was going to refinish. And I was telling Frank, I said, you know, I'm looking for another guitar. I'm saving up money. So I got something really special in the back here. He pulls out a Martin. I believe it was an 045, like Joan Baez model. If you can all envision, Joan had that small Martin. Inlaid Brazilian rosewood, beautiful. I mean, oh my God, I said, this is a beautiful, I didn't really know what it was. I knew it was a Martin and it was beautiful. I said, what does this guitar cost? He said, $125. Okay, and I said, oh, I don't have that kind of money. He said, well, son, if you don't, he said, but I got something else you might like. And he pulls out an Epiphone dreadnought shaped guitar, acoustic. And I bought it for $50. That I could afford, and it was a great guitar. Okay, it really was. Now let me back up. The 045 Martin original probably is worth about what I'm guessing, and you can help me, maybe 60, 70 grand now, 100 grand.
Right.
But it was about the instrument. It wasn't about me making a profit or anything. I ended up with the Epiphone for $50, and I love that guitar. In fact, I believe we were discussing this one day, and I said, I wish I still had it. It was a great guitar. But there it was. It was set up completely for the music I was trying to learn, bluegrass. So it handled steel strings quite well, and it handled all that Lester flat G runs you wanted to do on it and all that stuff. So I kept with it.
That's great. And another one that you know, sort of only mothers can do, as you were, you know, expressing interest in the mandolin.
Yeah.
Early on, that she found a record that had a picture of a mandolin.
She brought it home for you, right? Yeah, she was so supportive of all of it, and I couldn't find bluegrass records where I lived in Rancho, and you'd have to go to San Diego maybe in a music store and find them. But she did. She was out shopping, went to San Diego. She comes home and, you know, I see this album today. I bought it for you because it had a picture of a mandolin on it. And it was the Leuven Brothers, Tragic Songs of Life. And there's a picture of Ira and Charlie Leuven. And Ira's playing the F4 mandolin, but it's a drawing of them. And I said, wow, I'd never heard him before. And I put that on. This is all of 1961 at the time. I play the Leuven Brothers. I went, oh my God, the singing. And she didn't know what they sounded like. Who did? I put that, I loved it. I just loved it. So that was another great thing. And she was around until she was about 83, 84 years old. And right during the Desert Rose Band. So she saw it all happen. And she was very, very supportive and very proud of me, I must say. She was great. My dad didn't live long enough to see anything happen there. But the great story, of course, Randy, is here I am in my room trying to learn a Bill Monroe song. And my dad walks by and he says, he he'd had a martini, I believe. He says, Betty, are you sure this is our son, that he wasn't left on our doorstep by a family from Oklahoma or Kentucky? I mean, it was hilarious. And I remember that because I was all of 15 or 16 years old, you know.
And that intrigued me about, you know, other people who were here in this area and grew up Ry Cooter. You know, how does this kid from Santa Monica, you know, fall in love with the blues and, you know, just learn to master it at some point? And, you know, you're doing this.
I'm down
great
in
bluegrass.
And Ry and David Lindley. And we were all the same age. And it's so funny. I believe I was mentioning how important the Ash Grove was, the club, the Ash Grove, Ed Pearl's club, and how he'd bring in these incredible acts that we all loved, from Lightning Hopkins to Bill Monroe, Flatt and Scruggs, the Stanley Brothers, Doc Watson. I'll never forget Doc Watson coming to town and playing at the Ash Grove the first night. And we drove up from San Diego, and there was Ry Cooter. I didn't know these guys. David Lindley, I think Herb Peterson was probably in the audience. You could count it on your hands who was in there that loved the music. And of course, I believe Clarence White was there, of course, because he learned a lot from Doc on the acoustic guitar. And it was a great time. Great time.
Yeah. But, and, you know, by the same token, you, like so many of everybody in the generation at that time, you were pretty taken with the Beatles when they showed up on Sullivan in 1964. How did that hit you?
Well, I'd heard about them, and this band from England, a rock band. I go, what are you going to, I don't know what they sound like. But I happened to be, and then I was at this point in time, it was early 63. I turned 18. I had moved back to San Diego. And this, in the story, of course, my father had passed away and we moved to Los Angeles, and it was culture shock for my sister and I and my mother. She grew up in LA, but for me and my sister, it was major culture shock. But after turning 18 and working in LA and all of that for a while, not as a musician, but just a straight job and all of the above I had to do, was when my dad died, we really had no money. But I went back to San Diego and joined the Scottsville Squirrel Barkers. And I'd already known these guys and worked with them and messed around with them. And they called and asked me to come down and play mandolin with them. And that's where my mother, God bless her, she says, go ahead. I know you want to do this. Go on. You're going to be fine. I don't worry about you. And if you need me, you know where I am. Couldn't hear anything more rewarding than that. But anyway, so Randy, I come one Sunday night, I'm in LA, and I go over to my mom's and have dinner, and we put Ed Sullivan on. Everybody in that era on Sunday night turned on Ed Sullivan. It was a part of the routine. And there's the Beatles. And I go, oh my God. And I sit down and please me. Did they do? I can't remember. I know they did. I Want to Hold Your Hand. They came through that television screen like nobody's business. I mean, they just were so real and live. It was, of course, everything was live on Ed Sullivan, and they're singing and they're playing, and it was so electrifying, to lack of a bad a pun there, but I mean, it just came right out of the screen to you. And I went, wow. But there's so many elements in the Beatles that related to what I was doing, to country or bluegrass or that kind of singing, what they were doing and what they had gathered when they were learning. They listened to American records. They listened to a lot of country. Well, look what they cut, the Buck Owens tune. What's it
Act
called?
Naturally.
Thank you. Act Naturally. And
everybody's good. I've just seen Wants to Be My Baby.
Yeah, it was all Carl in that Perkins, great 2/4. Yeah. Exactly. 2/4 Carl Perkins country stuff. So they were very much aware of that. It was great.
And then, you know, you with the Scottsville Squirrel Barkers, you know, kind of a lot of people in their teens, you know, had a band, but you guys actually, you know, were pretty good. We're getting some kind of a reputation. I mean, I went talking to Lynn Ronstadt one time. She goes, yeah, I'd heard who Chris Hillman was because I'd listened to the Scottsville Squirrel Barkers.
Isn't that funny? And Graham Parsons was in Florida going to high school, and he said, he had a copy of the Squirrel Barkers, and he was saying, I was the band I wanted to be in. It was pretty close back then for him to say something like that. But the squirrel barkers were great. It was Bernie Ledden was a squirrel barker briefly. Right. Bernie Ledden's family was living in San Diego until they moved to Florida when Bernie was still in high school. But he was a squirrel barker. Oh gosh, we're about two or three shows after a couple of the guys got drafted and the band was starting to splinter apart. So I've known Bernie since he was 15, 16, long relationship, but the squirrel barkers were fantastic. And we would go to LA, we would play the Troubadour, which was right up the street from the Ash Grove, but dealt in a more commercial type folk music. And we would play the Hootenanny Night every Monday night. That was such an amazing place because things that developed out of there, out of the Troubadour, and those Monday nights, pretty amazing. You could write a book about that in itself. We would go up there and play, and then we made a record in 4 hours. We made a record live, cut it live to 2-track. And it's still in print. There's a company in England that has put it out, Scottsville Squirrel Barkers.
Oh, that's great. That's
all
great.
Those years, yeah. But the best part, I think, oh, we did. We actually got into a royalty payment period a couple of months ago. But initially, we made that record in 4 hours. We each got paid $10, and we each got a box of records when they were manufactured. Mm-hmm. What did we do that for? We did it so we could get work. There's nothing different.
Right.
You know, you make a record, it's sort of like a audition tape or something.
Your calling card, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. But it was a lot of fun. The Squirrel Barkers, one of the better bands I was in, I got to tell you. And Bernie Ledden had the great line. When we were young, we played without fear. I went, you know, you're right. You get called for a session when you're 19, you don't really think about it. You just go in and play, and what they want you to do, you do it. You don't think about it. You get older, you start thinking about it. And that can be a detriment.
Yeah,
thinking about what you're doing, and you're thinking, am I playing in time? Am I? So it was a good time. Yeah. And I met so many people then in the Squirrel Barkers. I met Clarence White. I met Herb Peterson. We were all of 18. And it was just, all I can say, it was just a wonderful time.
Yeah. And it's, again, just kind of invigorating reading the book. I feel like, you know, every time you turn around, there's an amazing musician there. You know, the Cal's Chorale TV show, you turn around and there's Glenn Hardin, you know, in the band, house band, playing piano. And, you know,
I'm sorry, but how about the house band for Cal Worthington was Gene Davis. And Gene Davis's band at one time had Delaney Bramlett playing bass, Glenn Hardin playing piano, Red Rhodes on steel. This other fellow was playing guitar. I can't remember his name, but he was also a singer on his own right. But that was the band, and they were good. You know, Gene Davis sort of looked like Charlie Louvin, as I recall. But anyway, I remember Delaney was the bass player. Yeah.
Yeah.
But well, there was such a connection with all these different people in country, and mostly country and bluegrass at the time, and then the rock bands came along in 65 and all that.
Yeah, such a vibrant scene. Well, you mentioned, you know, again with this the Beatles connection, you're down at the Troubadour on a Hoot Night and you see a guy go up and play I Want to Hold Your Hand on a 12-string acoustic, right?
Yeah, I see this guy. His hair is a little longer than the rest of us at the time, and he's playing a Gibson 12 acoustic 12 string. I don't think there was a pickup or anything. I think he just was playing it, and he was playing I Want to Hold Your Hand. And I went, who is that? And somebody says, oh, that's Jim McGuinn. I said, I don't know him. He said, well, you know, he's very good. I said, well, he sounds good. He's doing a Beatles song. Go figure. I said, he sounds pretty darn good. It wasn't long after when I had been working with this fellow, Jim Dixon. He had worked with the Golden State Boys, the band I was in, the Hillman, became known as the Hillman. And he also helped us get the Squirrel Barkers get on Crown Records. You know, he helped us get that together. He couldn't work with us in the Squirrel Barkers, but when the Golden State Boys came along a few months later, it was something he could handle, and we worked together at night in World Pacific. There's a connection. So I had been working with Jim Dixon, and then he calls me. I had this gig working in Westwood at Ledbetter's. It was a folk club. Randy Sparks owned it. And I had a gig after being in the, this is confusing, but it'll make sense. After being in the Golden State Boys, I get a gig, and my friend Larry Murray, who I'd worked with in the Squirrel Barkers, he says, you need to come down and audition for this because we make $100 a week and they have a place you can stay. And I went, that sounds good. I had nothing going on. And I got in the band, and it was not a very good band. It was sort of silly, but that's what I was doing. I get a call from Jim Dixon right after the, 2 months after the Beatles had hit Ed Sullivan. And he said, do you know Jim McGuinn, Gene Clark, David Crosby? I said, I know who they are. I don't know them. He says, have you heard him sing? I said, no. He said, well, come down. Can you come down after one of your gigs and listen to him at the studio? I said, yeah. I go down at 1 a.m. And there they are, 3 guys, a couple of acoustic guitars, and they sounded great. I went, wow, they sing really well. And Gene was writing songs at the time and very Beatlesque tunes. So I said, I think they sound great. And I must say, my standards were way up there. I'd been working with Vern Gosden and Rex Gosden.
Right.
And they could flat out get it. They were such good singers. That was my whole window, Randy, on authenticity, was working with Vern and Rex Gosden and Don Parmalee in the Golden State Boys, which is all in the book. I'm giving the book away, but it's okay. But that's how I really learned the music, working with these guys who all came from the South. They had 10 years on me and they really helped me. They took me under their wing and they were good guys, you know, and they kidded me to death and all the above. I was a little kid, but what an education. Well, anyway, story goes. So I go back, I listen to the 3 guys sing, and I get another call from Jim Dixon 2 weeks later. He says, hey, David Crosby was going to be the bass player and he's not comfortable. Can you play the bass? And it took me about 3 seconds. I went, I can handle that. Yeah. I just knew they were going to do something. I didn't know what they were going to do, but there was something special about the 3 of those guys. And I said, can you come down in a couple of days? There's a rehearsal. I said, okay. Do you have a bass? No, but I'll find one. I don't know to this day where I came up with this bass I found. It was a red bass, horrible instrument, made in Japan. There's a figure of $50 keeps going. I don't know if that's the Epiphone guitar I bought or the bass I got, but I go down to World Pacific and I walk in and I go, I'm assuming, Randy, there's going to be a complete setup of drums and amps and everything. A working rock band. And I'm going in there going, oh, God, Lord, get me through this, because I didn't know what I was doing. I had never played the bass. I never even held a bass. And I go in there, and there's one old amp against the wall. It's an old Epiphone again. The Epiphone name comes up. It's an old Epiphone amp. Roger's plugged into it. Jim McGuinn is plugged into it. And I go, okay. And so I plug into that amp with him. Gene's playing acoustic guitar. Mike Clark, the drummer, is actually seriously... He has 2 cardboard boxes, a cymbal, and a snare. That's his drum kit. Wow. And I mean, initially, I look at this, I'm looking at it, and I go, is this a skiffle band? Is this Lonnie Donegan? You remember Lonnie Donegan?
Oh, yeah.
Is your chewing gum lose its flavor? And what else do you do? Midnight, Let the Midnight Special?
Rock Island Line.
Rock, exactly. Thank you. And I loved that music. It was skiffle music. It was what John Lennon did before the Beatles. He was like, mm-hmm. a skiffle band. I thought they were a skiffle band. I said, what is this? And so then I realized they had no money. But I plugged in and off we went. And as I've always said, Roger, let's call him Roger now, because about 2 years later, he became Roger McGuinn. But Roger was probably the most seasoned player and had so much experience that we all sort of glommed onto him and what he was doing on the 12 string. Now, we were so enamored with the Beatles that we went to the Pix Theater on Hollywood Boulevard and saw Hard Day's Night probably 12 times. I mean, it's such a great movie. You watch that movie today. It is so well done. And it just describes that whole thing. I mean, the Beatles not only were good musicians and singers, they changed the fashion and they changed the culture and they healed us. Within a 2-month period, John Kennedy was killed the end of November. In a 2-month, December, January, February, the Beatles came out. Yeah. A major healing force for not only America, for the world.
Right.
And for people my age that had any musical inclination, it was it, boy. All of a sudden, guys like John Sebastian and and McGuinn and all these folk guys are John Phillips. I mean, whoever, there were folk guys, the Beatles come along and they go. You know? But I must say, I was very fortunate to be in the Byrds. I got the job. I actually asked Roger McGuinn 4 months ago. I was just joking around. I said, Roger, how many guys did you call for that bass job? About 27. He said, no, we didn't call. Yeah, Jim called and you were fine. You worked out perfectly. I said, good. He said, why are you worried about that now? It's been over 50 years. I said, well, I guess it's just my nature. But anyway, I love being in the Byrds. It was a wonderful thing.
You know, the cliche is that the bass player is the worst player in the band, and
exactly.
You know, by default they give it to the guy who can't play guitar, but in your case, you know, you've been playing guitar but also working on mandolin. Do you feel like that just the skill set for playing the mandolin translated to the bass in a way, because you were, you know, like Paul McCartney, became this very melodic bass player, not just, you know, playing root notes and that sort of stuff, but really, you know, bringing some melody to what you were doing. And I wondered how much, if any, overlap there was.
Oh, I'm sure there was. I mean, more so from the guitar. And I approached the bass initially not knowing what I was doing, like it was a bluegrass rhythm guitar with the runs, you know, on the runs that one would play in a bluegrass song on guitar. And yes, playing mandolin lead, mandolin stuff helped that immensely. But McCartney was a big influence, because I started out and I'm going, okay. And I remember it was, who was the bass player? Joe, I don't remember, session player. But he played with a pick. McCartney played with a pick. And I went, okay. And I was used to playing with a pick anyway. And so I learned to play with a pick, and I listened to McCartney. I listened to a lot of people. And then later, as I continued learning more, I think I started to figure the bass out about the end of the first album. And then I got very comfortable with it. But I think other guys that played in the same vein, so to speak, Jack Bruce and Cream played very melodically. I loved John Entwistle. I started listening to The Who. I went, my God, he's good. And McCartney was fantastic bass player. I think Paul McCartney's the one that said something like that you were saying about the bass players, usually the fat guy who's not as good as the other guys, and they put him in the back. And I'm going, wait a minute. Oh, first of all, I wasn't fat. But, you know, I mean, it was part of the journey. I really enjoyed it later on playing the bass, especially when we got into things like 8 Miles High and Rock and Roll Star and things. I really had a good time playing the bass and all of the above. But it was a constant learning process, as it is with any instrument. You know, you play, and so it's a constant learning process. Yeah.
Well, and you have discussed that to a fair degree, both of the, you know, the impact the Beatles had on you in terms of how, you know, rock was changing at the time, and the foundation that you had with the bluegrass and the country stuff and folk. But just again, here in Southern California, Beach Boys, Brian Wilson, did that harmony stuff make you guys sit up and take notice?
Oh boy, did it. Yeah. I know Dave, I could say this safely, and I mean, David Crosby would agree. I mean, David Crosby and Brian Wilson both learned and listened from the same source. Four freshmen.
Yeah.
Hilos. Those harmonies were not coming out of a Baptist church gospel group, as we all know from country music and bluegrass, and to some degree rock and roll. No, David and Brian Wilson, I think, really listened a lot to the Hilos and the Four Freshmen. And I love the Four Freshmen. I'll never forget that album, Four Freshmen and Five Trombones, but they were fantastic. Was it something I went after and listened to a lot? No, it wasn't. It was totally alien from what I was used to listening to and doing. But they were a big influence on David. And that really, David to this day is still a great singer. Was so good in the early days in the Byrds. The harmony lines he would come up with were just so beautiful. I mean, and he was, finally got that out of him, Randy. He was in Glee Club. Everybody go out, put that out there. And he loves Twitter. David Crosby was in Glee Club in high school. But no, he has got the voice. He's really something.
Well, once you guys, came together in the studio, Jim brought you Tambourine Man.
Yes, he did.
Right.
Jim Dixon knew Bob Dylan's manager, Albert Grossman. And I think Bob had cut it already, but whatever he brought us, and Bob had said it was fine if we wanted to cut it. And Albert Grossman said, it's fine. The guys can do whatever they want with it. And when Jim brought it into us at World Pacific, this is a song you guys have to listen to. And nobody liked it because it was written very much so in a country style and nobody could relate to it really. And then three beautiful, if not four beautiful verses, but we could only use one if indeed we did cut it and ended up cutting it anyway. As a single release, we could only use one verse because of the time restraints on AM radio. So if you had 2 minutes, 30 seconds or 2 minutes, 40 seconds, you're barely getting one verse in there. But McGuinn, to his credit, as I say, was a seasoned player, took that song home and messed around with it and brought it back in and had changed the time signature around from 2-4 to 4-4 and made it danceable. And that's where Dylan heard us singing it. And he said, God, you can dance to this. Fantastic. It was great. So we got the stamp of approval. And originally we had a singles deal with Columbia Records. And that's another great story, which you'll find in the book, with Miles Davis, who none of us knew, but who actually did a favor and called up the head of Columbia and got us a deal. Now go figure that one.
I thought that was great.
So the fellow that Jim Dixon had played our demo of Tambourine Man for was named Benny Shapiro. He owned a club called the Renaissance, a jazz club, which actually was across the street from Ciro's on Sunset Boulevard. And he takes it over and he plays it for Benny. And Benny's daughter was 13 or 14 and she heard it upstairs in her room. She ran down the stairs. She says, who is that band, Dad? I love that group. Who is it? And Benny Shapiro says, that's good enough for me. He says, I'm going to make a phone call. Well, we didn't know. He called Miles Davis. He said, do me a solid here. Would you talk to, I think it was Goddard Lieberson.
Goddard Lieberson, yeah.
Exactly. President of Columbia. And we got a singles deal, which meant if it takes off, we'll do an album. Basically what that meant. Initially they signed Roger and Gene and David, and Mike and I got an equal part of the deal. Of course, it was very fairly done. But and then we did an album. Of course, then we renegotiated the deal. We were all on the label.
Well, it wouldn't have been crazy at the time because Joan Baez was recording Bob's stuff. Peter, Paul, and Mary. Mm-hmm. Cher had her version of one. But what I thought was interesting and telling about that was Jim Dixon bringing it in and saying, you guys need to go for substance and depth, make records you can be proud of. I mean, exactly. that's not always a guiding principle working in the music business.
I think that came right along when we said, we don't like this song about Tambourine Man. And I think that was shortly thereafter we said, you need to go for substance in your music. You want to make a record you're proud of in 40 years. Great advice. Absolutely. You want to go for a quick hit, boy, girl, da 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 da, hot car, girl, boy. Okay. Or do you want to make something that is a piece of art that you will be proud of in 40 years? And most of the time, we hit it right. We didn't always hit them out of the park. We, like everybody else, you do some silly things you think are really hip at the time, and it doesn't always work out the way. But most of the time, we had some good stuff and. A lot of the time, and we had stuff we're very proud of,
Yeah. One of the another interesting sort of historical point that I was relieved to see, that where you talked about the first session when you recorded Tambourine Man, and Jim/Roger, I think, was the only Byrd that played on it. Exactly. Yes, because it was, they were using the guys who we later called the Wrecking Crew, and yeah, the pros in the studios. Mm-hmm. And I always wondered how that sat with you guys. Did you feel like you got aced out of your opportunity, or and you talk about it in the book, so yeah.
I didn't feel left out. I knew even at that young age that Columbia was looking at it like they were hedging their bet. They were going, okay, let's do this the very best. And Terry Melcher was our producer. I think Terry was involved in that decision too. But I think that was probably the right thing to do. If I'd have been in Columbia Records' shoes as a producer and exec, I would have probably brought in the Wrecking Crew for that one song. But it's so funny, over the years, Randy, people go, well, the Byrds never played on their records. Well, you can tell if you listen to the first album. That's us. And it was good. Part of me sometimes goes, it's such a slick record, Tambourine Man, that I would have loved to have heard what we would have done with it. With a little more practice and work, I would have loved to have heard what we would have done, but it doesn't matter. It got us in the door big time. Boy, did it ever. It was a number one single in the States, all over Europe and England and everything. So that was it. That just started the whole ball game.
Yeah. Well, and you talked to him about that, about the effect it had on Dylan too, he liked the record. Of course, you know, songwriters always like somebody making a hit out of their songs. That's always a good thing. Mm-hmm. But that, he wound up coming down to Ciro's when you guys were playing there and joining you on harmonica. And I think you mentioned in the book that maybe that was the inspiration for him to plug in with an electric band. No?
I think it helped. It helped him make that full commitment. But I don't know if I'd be the one to say we did it. I mean, I would probably ask McGuinn, but I mean, we were there. I mean, I think we were instrumental, terrible here, but getting him over the fence there. I think he wanted to do that. We're speculating because he's not in the room with us, but I mean, I think he wanted to play electric and he wanted to expand. He didn't want to be the one guitar harmonica guy, you know? It's like, it's sort of when he was, one most brilliant songs ever was I was so much older than I'm younger than that now. I love that line where he goes, who am I talking about this stuff at 22 years old or whatever, right yeah. Where he changes his whole outlook. It's
interesting too with the intersection of the Byrds and the Beatles that Derek Taylor left England, came to the States and wound up working with you guys. And what was your experience with him? What was your take on Derek, who was one of the just legendary
loved him
publicists?
He came over and initially was working with the Beach Boys and he took us on. And I loved him. He was extremely intelligent, very funny, just edgy, funny man. it was just great. And if you really got him upset, like if one of the members got him upset, he'd sort of ever so subtly write something terrible about them in an article for 16 magazine or something. He would write these articles for those kind of magazines. But yeah, he talked us into going to England in the summer of 65, and we had just been on a tour of the States around Tambourine Man, out promoting it. I think he wanted to triumphantly march back to London, the conquering hero, and to show Brian Epstein, look what I had did over in the States. Look what I have. I brought the da da da. But he was great. So we get to know the Beatles. They came and watched us play and hung out with us. They're very, very, very sweet guys and very nice to us. And for that period, they were saying, oh, the Byrds are the greatest band. They're our favorite band. Oh, that was wonderful stuff going on there, you know. And that's, of course, in the book where we're out that one night in London and we'd done a gig and we're at, I don't know if it was Brian Jones's house or what, Lennon's there and Brian Jones and various people, other musicians and I don't think all the Byrds were there, but pretty much all of us, I think. But that's where Lennon, and I'm Mr. Shy. And that's where Lennon, about an hour into this thing where we're together, and he goes, looks at me, he goes, does this one talk? And I turned bright red. Of course, you know, I mean, I'm so shy and embarrassed, I turned bright red. But it was so funny. In hindsight, you look back at that, and of course, that's a wonderful thing that was handed to him. you know, you could get some mileage out of that line, you know.
Yeah,
it's great.
Well, there was also a session where you and Crosby got invited to come in with the African musician Leta Mbulu. Mm-hmm. And here you're the guy who started out having not held a bass in your hand, and now you're called into a session as a session bass player. How extraordinary was that to you? What did that say to you about?
We had the same management. Hugh Masekela was going to produce Leta Mbulu. And Hugh had this manager as we did, and I think a couple of the Monkees, and this fella, terrible man, terrible thief. But anyway, so Hugh called David and I to come and do this demo session for Leta Mbulu, who is basically a jazz chanteuse, I mean, a singer. She was like Peggy Lee to me. And we go in and it's all South African players, except for one fella who played congas, Big Black. He was a very well-known jazz player at the time, a conga percussionist, and he was on the session. Everybody else was from South Africa. And it was fantastic. And so I went from being the fat guy in the back who couldn't play the bass, who they, I love that line. Right. But in the middle of, we do this song and the playback, and Leta is in the booth listening, and I'm outside, and she pushes the button and she says, "Chris, you're cooking." And I went, "Wow. That was really nice for her to say that." And what did I do, Randy? I go home and write a song, the first song I'd ever written, words and music, but it wasn't a jazz song. I go right home and write a country song. I don't know where that came from, but something opened that door in me. And all week after that session, I think it was one or two sessions we did, I start writing songs, and they were coming out pretty good because I showed them to McGuinn, and he was very impressed. Because the first rehearsal, we got back together to rehearse for a tour or for an album. I can't remember. But Crosby shows up and he's one of his moods. And Roger says, "I think you better sit down and listen to what Chris has written." And David goes, "Yeah, right." I was the fat bass player still. I love that. And I play a couple songs and Roger says, later he said in an interview, a year or two later, he says, "Chris was a late bloomer. He really was. He was very shy. But when he bloomed, he blossomed." It was such a cool line. I love that. But, and we cut all the songs that I wrote. And then I wrote one with Roger, Rock and Roll Star, it was great. So we all started writing together. I was writing alone. I was writing with David and Roger.
Well, there are so many instances where I really feel like you were a catalyst, or like the guy at the right place in the right time, and sort of triggered, help things happen. I mean, you were on the front end of the musicians in that community who went to live in Laurel Canyon. Yeah. And then, this whole community blossoms around that. Mm-hmm. You're in the bank and chatting with the guy who comes in next to you in line about the music you like, and it's Graham.
Yeah.
So I just think that you've had a hand in these things and haven't always gotten the credit. Not that you're out for credit, but
I used to get that. I remember somebody saying, "Well, it seems like every time you read about the song Sin City, they talk about Graham." I said, "Well, it used to bother me." I said, "It used to bother me because I really had half of that written before he got up. We were sharing a house in the valley at the time. Before he woke up, I had half of it done, but what did it matter?" And I believe my wife said to me once, she said, "Well, do you want to trade places with him?" Well, it's not a nice thing to say, but I came across that. But I wasn't looking for that, Randy. I was a musician, and I didn't really care about that. I wasn't looking to be the leader of the band. I wasn't looking to be Bruce Springsteen or Van Morrison. I wasn't good enough at the time to assume that. But I learned how to do that. I did learn and got better at everything that I did by working at it and practicing and all the above.
Well, I think you distilled it pretty beautifully in the book. You said, you know, I wanted to make great music and Graham wanted to be a star. And, yeah, you know, there's validity to both things, but, you know, they come at different prices sometimes.
The first year when we hired him, in the Byrds, he was good. He was ambitious. He had two great songs he brought into the mix. Another pun that we don't need, but he brought two great songs in Hickory Wind in 100 years from now, and that he had co-written with Bob Buchanan, this fellow that I knew. And that was, they were perfect for what we were going to do, Sweetheart of the Rodeo. And he was very ambitious in that sense. And, but we, you know, funny enough, we already had been messing around with country songs way back on the first album or second album, We did Satisfied Mind, Porter Wagner, a big hit for Porter Wagner. We were always playing with it, and it wasn't a stretch for us to do all of that. But unfortunately, I lost old Graham about the second year, and he just went after other things that weren't conducive to what I wanted to do. And that was play music. As I believe our good friend, Tom Petty, said to you in an interview you did with him, when he said, Chris, I don't think Chris ever liked show business. And I didn't. I didn't want to be in a limousine. It didn't matter to me about all that. I was an ensemble player. You know? And then I finally ended up running the Burritos after Graham left. And I of course, Desert Rose Band, where I ramrodded that bunch. So, and very successfully.
Yeah. Well, you know, you mentioned in the book, you said that country rock isn't a term that you've always embraced. Why not?
Oh, because we had come through, I always felt it was a lazy journalist. So Tambourine Man, we were a folk rock band. Okay. I said, okay. And then it went, before it got to country rock, we went through folk rock, raga rock, which is one of my favorites, raga rock. God knows where that came from. Psychedelic rock. And this is all on the Byrds. And then country rock. But I finally became friends with the term. At a point in time, I said, what does it matter? You know, I mean, I think what cured all of it was the term Americana. All of a sudden we were put into this big place, and it was under the umbrella of Americana music, and that covers a lot of genres of music.
But
still within the parameters of roots music, right? I guess.
Well, Mr. Spaceman was pretty country record.
It was a country record, yeah. Yeah.
The Burritos Stills invited you to come, you know, play with the stuff he was working on, which became Manassas, you know, after he started his run with CSN and CSNY. But what I love is on a couple of levels is the story you tell about he's asking you to play mandolin on some stuff and says, geez, that mandolin of yours isn't very good.
He had, we had played at a club in Boulder, Tulagi's, and Stephen was living in Colorado then, and he came to see us, you know, and we hung out after the show. I went up to his house in Gold Hill above Boulder, and then he calls, or one of his guys called me, a month later, and about coming to Miami and playing on some sessions that they were doing. Stephen was doing another solo album. He had done one. He was on a sort of a break from Crosby and Nash, and he had had some success with Love the One You're With and Change Partners, very successful. And prior to me going to Florida, I see him in Cleveland. The Burritos are on the road. We had a night off, and I see Stephen Stills is playing in Cleveland. So we go see him. I talk to him again. Then I get the call for the sessions. I said, yes, we can come down there. He wanted Byron Berline, who was playing with us in the Burritos, Al Perkins on steel, and myself. I believe Rick Roberts came too. We go to Miami, playing on some sessions. And it was the first day, I think, after we had cut a couple tracks, and he says, can I talk to you for a minute? I said, sure. He says, you know that mandolin I saw you playing in Colorado? That's not a good instrument. I said, well, you don't tell somebody that. You don't really say, hey, your guitar is horrible. You don't really want to do that. I said, you know, and I started laughing. I said, this isn't very good. I just, you know, there was a period in the Byrds where I didn't have a mandolin, and I picked this one up around the Sweetheart of the Rodeo time and bought it and started playing again because I hadn't played for 4 years. He said, it wasn't a good instrument. He says, but I want to show you something. So he pulls out this case, opens it, and he says, what do you think of this? And I said, my God, that's a Gibson 19, I look in the label, 1924 F5. Lloyd Lohr F5. I said, my gosh. He says, well, try it out. So I play it and I go, this is beautiful, fantastic. He says, do you like it? I said, it's fantastic. He said, it's yours. I said, what? I want you to have it. I said, no, I can't take this. No. I said, I want you to have it. I said, what are you doing? He said, do you remember what you did for the Springfield? I said, what? He said, you got us a job at the Whiskey. I said, oh my gosh, I told Elmer Valentine to hire you for a couple nights because I thought you guys were good. I'd heard you practice, and he did. But he kept you over for 2 weeks. He says, that's why. He said, you got us going in LA. I said, I didn't do anything. Come on, you know. So this is funny. So I said, wow, looking at this thing, I couldn't even take my eyes off of it. The next day we're playing, we do a song. He says, can I talk to you for a minute? I went, oh God, he's going to take the mandolin back. I did something wrong. I go in the other room. He says, what do you think about putting a band together? I said, well, I 2 seconds. I went, okay. Well, here, Randy, I took the burritos pretty far, as far as I could after Graham left. We were working a lot. We were selling records. And it was actually working out quite well, but I'd also been, spinning my wheels for a few years with the Burritos, and I get an offer like working with Stills and the guys he was working with in the studio, we're all great players. I went, yes, I love the idea. And just being kept on my toes, working with the caliber of musicians he had around him was enough for me. Regardless of the mandolin didn't figure into the equation. It was really, and I think Steven in 1972, when we did this, he was at the top of his game. And as a player, as a singer, songwriter, I learned so much music being around Stills. I mean, by osmosis, if nothing else, I learned songwriting tips. I learned a lot of guitar watching him play. He was such a great player. And singer, and we wrote together, and it was a wonderful time. And 2 years,
that is just so sweet. Again, that's just sort of the paying back the debt of.
Oh, I know.
Elmer, you should hire these guys.
Well, I think someone had tried, to get them booked in there, and Elmer didn't, but he knew me from the Byrds. So he said, I'm going to take a chance because I trust you. Right. I said, oh boy. I said, what if it doesn't work out? He said, you're done in this town. No, he didn't. He didn't, but it worked out quite well. And I took David down to see him, Crosby. I said, you got to hear these guys, Buffalo Springfield, take him to the Whiskey. He goes, they're okay. It's like the time we're driving. This isn't in the book, by the way. This is an extra added attraction. We're on the road driving, and I turn on a country station. There's a steel guitar. And I said, Crosby, you hear that instrument? You like the sitar. You should love this instrument. It's a sliding scale. He says, I hate that stuff. Well, within 2 years, Jerry Garcia is playing on Teach Your Children. I said, these are great David Crosby stories. Love him dearly. That's great. He's a character.
Well, in the same way that you told Graham he should come down to the club in Washington and hear this girl singer. That you heard, which was Emmy Lou.
Yeah.
And that happened.
I didn't think I would be able to do anything with her. I was busy. I had other things I was doing. In fact, I had just gotten the Manassas gig and I was finishing up a burrito show in Maryland or someplace. And that's where I saw Graham. And I had to spend an hour talking him into calling her. He said, well, I want to find a girl singer and make a record. I said, this is the lady for you. She's working in a club in Georgetown, Emmy Lou Harris. Well, give her a call. Finally, he calls her and she sort of knew who he was. And he said, well, can you pick me up at the train station in Georgetown or wherever the train goes. She said, no, I don't know who you are. I don't know you that well. You're going to have to, we'll meet up and we'll talk. And so he finally goes over there and they got along great. And she goes to LA and they made some records. And he was very, very helpful to her and opening her up to country music. The Leuven brothers, especially, right, things like right. that. Yeah.
Yeah. Well, I mean, there's so much in the book and there's been so many great, you know, stops along the way that you've had, and don't want to short shrift Souther Hillman Furey or McGuinn Clark Hillman or
McGuinn
Hillman. but I do want to just talk for a minute about Desert Rose Band, which was sure. absolutely one of my favorite bands of that
Thank
era,
you.
Which, yeah. which, I always like to use Steve Earle's line that you guys came up during the great credibility scare of the '80s,
the great folk scare.
Yeah. But there were all these.
No, you're right. It was the credibility scare. That's what he said. Yeah.
Right. Yeah. So, you know, Lyle Lovett and Katie Lang and all these really interesting acts that you know, just had, they had substance. They were, you know, the musical bona fides were there. And there was a time where you actually were able to get radio airplay too. And you guys had hits. And finally, you know, Chris Hillman is running the show. Did you feel like that it was just circumstances finally coming together, or was it this culmination of you sort of just building the all the skills that were required to do that?
It was a little of both. I didn't really want to put a band together, and it was John Jorgensen who was pushing this deal, and when we get a record deal, which I wasn't looking for, okay, we got a record deal, and we record, and we put out the first single, which was a remake of Johnny and Jack's Ashes of Love. It got into number 20 or something. I went, whatever. And then the next song we put out starts climbing. Love Reunited starts going. All of a sudden, it's top 10. And still going, and I couldn't believe it. And I said to my wife, I said, this isn't supposed to happen. You know, I said, I'm not supposed to have a hit single on the Billboard charts. But I was seeing, I'm just in awe of it all. It got to number 3. And after that, all the subsequent singles we put out started to get into the top 10 with number ones and all of the above. I went, unbelievable. But I'll tell you, it's not me. It was the band was great. The musicianship was top notch. The singing, Herb Peterson, John Jorgensen, Bill Bryson, all great singers. J.D. Manus, who I'd worked with on Sweetheart of the Rodeo. The only guy that I had never worked with was Steve Duncan, was the drummer, and he was great. So one of the best bands ever, I think. And I was in that band the longest, 8 years. I had felt that I had gone from being the lieutenant of the ship, and I was the captain now. I was captaining the ship and singing the songs, writing them, and singing lead and MC and running the band, blah blah blah. But my confidence, of course, had been gained over the last 20 years. I'd finally gotten hold of myself, started to like myself. Right around Manassas, I really got to where I was figuring out singing and all of the above. So, but yeah, I always felt Desert Rose, and that's a classic one, Randy. We would be opening shows for Reba McEntire and Merle Haggard, and just wonderful people. And Reba was so sweet to us and always made sure we had a sound check. And she said to me, I was an opening act one night, or she said that to me one night, I was an opening act, and she made her guys stay extra so we could have a sound check. I'm just wonderful people. And we had such a good time. And we went back on the Opry after the Byrds aborted the attempt in 1968. We're on the Opry again. And I think I'd run into Skeeter Davis, who was our friend during the 1968 debacle. And she says, a lot different now, huh? Or something like that. I said, Skeeter, you remember that? She says, oh, yeah. She says, you guys got, it wasn't fair, but I said, well, you know, we were a little disrespectful in not doing what we were supposed to do that night. That's in the book. You can all read that. But
that's a great part of the book, too.
I got to tell you, and most of this book is about picking yourself up and off the ground and keep going forward, you know. And I always felt a door opened and it looked
like a pretty good thing, I'd go through that door. And very rarely did it ever turn out to be a bad thing. There were some bands that weren't the greatest, but they all had their good moments, all of them, you know.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, well, you also cover the 50th anniversary Sweetheart of the Rodeo tour that you and Roger and Marty Stewart did, which mm-hmm. again, having attended two of those shows in L.A., I will attest to what a musical joy that was.
I loved it.
And you said I had such a passion for the music when I was in my late teens. This is in the part where you're talking about that tour, mm-hmm. looking back on everything. I lived it and breathed it 24 hours a day. Never thought about the money, the future, chasing down stardom. It was always all about the music. And mm-hmm. I just find that so refreshing and revealing of who you are.
And, but that's what it was, you know. It's so
appreciative of that.
Well, but Randy, you know, it really was about that. It was what generated that passion, and that's the magic of music. And I'm sure Linda would agree with me as she approached her book this in the very same way. Well, I certainly borrowed from her inspiration, but that's what it was about. That's what it was. It's all about. Look at me, Mom. That's why we got into it. You know, it's, if you think back to the very basics, you say, why did you want to be a musician? And it's sort of, look at me, Mom, I'm on stage, you know, whatever. But there were times I always mention in the book where I thought I would go back to college, right? I'd only done a sort of a short semester in a junior college, but I always thought, well, next year I'm going to apply for the next semester. Maybe major in history or English lit or something, but it never happened. I wasn't supposed to do that. And things worked out quite well. And I think one of the most important things is, as far as me and being shy and not having that confidence, and when I realized that I was okay, and I think that applies to anybody in this world, that when you end up, you make friends with yourself and forgive yourself, you know, things look pretty bright after that. You know, you make friends with yourselves. Everything's good. Everybody else has issues. We all have issues, but we keep going and we keep doing our very best. I know this sounds like some smarmy sermon, but it isn't. It's really what I believe in, you know, and keep yeah. going forward.
Yeah. Well, I thought we could sort of bring it full circle here with one of the things that's toward the end of the book, and it ties in with the Far West Folk Alliance, that in 2013, there was this really, I think, for me, very sweet and touching chain of events that was set in motion. There, you were honored as one of the best of the West musicians singled out that okay. year, mm-hmm. and how that culminated in, you know, sort of what has to be one of the musical high points of your life.
It was. And I thank Russ and Julie Paris, who would still do put on house concerts. And they are so, involved and impassioned with the music. They do that. But they had nominated me, I guess, for that. I loved that. I thought that was so, I just loved it. And not, my whole background was that. It was folk music. It was, to this day, where I still will go on stage and play some of those older songs, you know, that I grew up playing. There it is. It's such a connection. And I think one of the magical things of the Byrds was that we were all came out of folk music. And we didn't know what a garage rock band was. We didn't. And we didn't have a blueprint, and we didn't know anything about that. We just plugged in and off we went. And that, I love that, just sheer abandonment and just go for it, you know?
Yeah, well, and the amazing thing was that, so they got all these testimonials to talk about, you know, the different contributions that you'd made. One of which came from Tom Petty.
Yes.
Longtime fan and disciple, musically, certainly. And Herb winds up going on tour with Tom.
Correct.
And then comes out the idea that Tom should do a record with Chris. I mean, what a brilliant idea that was. And that you guys were able to pull it off.
It was, once again, I'm going, well, I didn't see doing another record. I don't know why. I just said, you know, I've done a lot of Desert Rose and a lot of solo stuff after that, a lot of stuff with Herb. And at that point, I just didn't feel like I was going to do another record. And then Herb says, call Tom up, call him up. I said, okay. Well, I didn't know Tom that well. I knew him from 1978, but we had the funniest conversation. He says, well, what do you think? Do you want to do this? I said, well, do you want to? And well, do you want me to? And it was so back and forth. I said, oh, Tom, my God, I'd be honored to play with you, but I've got some songs, but I don't know. He says, I'm not worried about that. He says, I'll let you know if I don't like your songs. I said, good. I said, well, I love the honesty. I just love that. So he said, the funny thing was, is Tom, this is going on Rounder Records. He said, okay, what are we working with? I said, about 30,000, 35,000. He says, that's going to be a challenge. Here's a fellow used to having a budget of quite a lot more than that. But he said, but we can make it work. We'll go down to my studio in the Valley and cut the basics. We'll do some work here at the house. And fantastic. But such a great guy. And Herb takes me over to his house before we started this whole thing. And out of nowhere, Tom says, play me some songs. I was unprepared. I went, oh my God. I was nervous. Pick up one of his guitars. I start playing. He said, okay, cool. A folk album. I said, Tom, I don't know what it's going to be. I mean, if we put drums and plug in, it's not going to be a folk album. He says, no, it won't, but whatever. Let's do it. Point being, here's a man that loved every kind of music. He did. He loved so every style of music within the realm of good taste, mind you. But, and you hear that if you listen to Tom, that's the show on XM Satellite, Tom's show, and you hear the Heartbreakers doing a Bo Diddley song or Jimmy Reed song. They did it because they loved the song and they worked it up and cut it. Love that. See, that to me is just total musicianship is total love of music. And not worrying about what it's going to do for you. Am I going to get a new car because of this song? Am I going to have a hit record? Will everybody love me? No, you're doing this because you love this music. And you love it so much, you're going to make other people love it. And it's that simple.
Yeah, and he was so happy about the way that came out. I sat down.
I hope so. Sometimes I ask Ryan Ulate, this wonderful engineer, and I said, did Tom like? He said, Tom loved the album. He just wanted more drums. I started laughing. I said, really? He said, oh no, Tom loved drums. Well, actually Ryan did in his genius as an engineer, put some drum tracks on a few things and he sounded great. But no, we had a good time with that record. And I really got to know him in that 5-6 week period of working together. And a lot of time we would sit in the other room and tell rock stories that were hilarious.
Yeah.
And I just held him in the highest of places. I've never met a more humble man, Randy. I'd drive up and he'd come out and help me take my guitar in. If I didn't leave it at the studio overnight, he'd come and get it out of the car for me. I said, what are you doing? He says, no, let me do this. And I've always said, I've never met a man that more humble that occupied the position he held in the world, as he was greatly mourned when he passed away, because he was every man. He was all of us. He was just so, you know.
Well, I think he was, I felt like he was always still a fan at heart, just such
a fan
of music.
Yes, yeah. He was. That's exactly what, and you knew him really well and you had some great talks with him, you know, which is wonderful. That last interview you did was great. It broke my heart. I'm sorry, you know that. And as it broke all of our hearts, and we were in Nashville when that happened, and you know the story. And
right.
I was going to cancel the 4 shows we had left because we were going to end up at the Troubadour with the Heartbreakers sitting in with John and Jorgensen and Herb and I. And I was ready to cancel them. I was so upset. And then out of nowhere, Roger McGuinn calls me. He said, don't do it. Do not cancel those shows. He said, Tom, one thing Tom Petty would not like is if you did that. You go celebrate him in the music. It was a wonderful wisdom. And Roger knew him better than any of us. And the last thing I would say about Tom, if anybody could have gotten the Byrds into the studio, it would have been Petty. He was the guy that could have got us in to do one more great grand hurrah.
Yeah.
And that's okay.
Yeah. Well, thank you, Chris. It's, you know, a treat talking to you always. And
we've had many wonderful conversations over the years. And this was one of them.
For me too. So thank you. Congratulations again on the book. And you know, for folks who haven't picked it up yet, by all means, go out and get it. It's a great read, and you'll enjoy it as much as I did. Thanks.
Thank you so much.
I see my old friends in so many places, and I can't remember their names. And it takes me back home to all of the places where my memories will always remain. And I'm just biding my time. Dust on my saddle and clouds in my mind. I'm just biding my time till I leave this old city behind. And I'm tired of the concrete and people so busy, their lives nothing more than a flame. Fire burns inside me, green pastures are calling. I'll find peace of mind once again. And I'm just biding my time. There's dust on my saddle and clouds in my mind. I'm just biding my time till I leave this old city behind. Oh, listen to the trees. You feel the cool breeze. Isn't this the way it's meant to be? And I'm just biding my time till I leave this old city behind. Till I leave this old city behind. Here she comes again. Oh, I've fallen once before, I just can't help myself. And I'm going for it once more. And she'll win again. She'll take my heart, she'll take my soul, and leave me lying there. And I'm going for it once. Think it all out, say you'll never do it again. When your loving baby moves a little closer, no sense trying to breathe.